My name is Gail Lewis. I'm in the Department of Psychosocial Studies here at Birkbeck, but I'm really here not as an academic of the university. I'm here as a concerned citizen, and although it's got nothing to do with my employer, I'm a serial convictor. I was convicted in my teenage years for drug possession. It was me that was arrested and not the white girl that was with me. I was arrested in 1977 for being involved in Lewisham, the anti-fascist march in Lewisham, after the police had hit me in the face, smashed my glasses off my face, broken them, and then arrested me to say for affray and threatening behaviour. I was arrested for a driving offence. It seems to me then that the warning that came to us in the 1970s through a journal called State Research, that was a left-orientated journal that monitored meticulously the growing development of a state that was what we would now call moving towards securitisation, in which all of the arms of the state, whether they be about welfare or education, as well as criminal justice, were involved ever more in the gathering of data on the population in order simply to store it and record it for use at some time. That agenda, it seems to me, has now met the moment of the confessional that we're now in, where we simply declare what we have done in some kind of gesture, apparently to a benign and disinterested state, as our institutions that are supposed to take care of us and allow us to pursue some desire of opportunity are ever more incorporated into the arms of a securitizing and securitized state. That agenda is what we're in the context of today, it seems to me, and that question that organizes and orientates the discussion, you know, are universities becoming overly concerned with the risk, with risk management and securitization policies, and at what social, political, and ethical cost? That's the terms of our discussion today. I'm really, really happy to be able to be here as chair, and thanks, Sarah, for inviting me to do that. I'm going to introduce the speakers now, and they will speak one by one for between 10 and 15, but I'm informed that one will go to between 10 and 12, but one will go to 15, I understand, but they're sharing it out because we're a collective here, so we know how to distribute and redistribute. So I'll introduce the speakers and then just say what the terrain that they're going to cover. And then there will be a bit of a dialogue between them. They may want to ask questions of each other in order to begin to set the terrain, and then we can open it out for a wider discussion and conversation, hopefully leading towards how might we begin to organise and get together collectively to reframe this terrain and mobilise against it. Okay. So the first speaker will be Sarah Lamble, who's a senior lecturer and assistant dean for criminology in the School of Law here at Birkbeck. Sarah's research interests focus on cultures of punishment, alternatives to imprisonment, and issues of gender and sexuality in the criminal justice system. And Sarah will give a summary of key reasons why universities should not engage in blanket screening of of student applications on the basis of criminal conviction. She'll be followed by Patrick, who's senior lecturer in criminology at Manchester Met. His current research is concerned with processes of criminalisation and the debilitating effects of criminal justice processes and practice upon marginalised groups and communities. His work particularly is involved with challenging the durability of differential treatment and racialized disproportionality within criminal justice systems for Black, Asian, and minority ethnic people and communities. And Patrick will talk about discrimination in the criminal justice system, particularly against young Black men, and how that discrimination is replicated in criminal conviction screening. Wael Kasim is a freelance writer, a Birkbeck student, and an organiser with Defend the Right to Protest, which campaigns against police brutality, kettling, and the use of violence against those who have a right to protest. Defend the Right to Protest also supports those protesters who've been arrested, bailed or charged and are fighting to clear their names. Wael will talk about the impact of criminal conviction screening on student activists and protesters, and the potentially chilling effect that such screening may have on student activism. Sasha Dark is senior lecturer in criminology at the University of Westminster and coordinator of the mentoring scheme with the British Convict Criminology Group, which supports prisoners and ex-prisoners in establishing themselves as academics in the field of criminology and related disciplines. Sasha will talk about the impact of criminal conviction, screening and monitoring on staff and students with convictions, and will talk about the work of the British Convict Criminology Group. And Christopher Stacey is Director of Services for Unlock, a charity which provides information, advice, training and advocacy dealing with the ongoing effects of criminal convictions. He's one of the country's foremost experts on the criminal record disclosure system and in understanding and challenging the long-term effects associated with having a criminal record. Christopher will talk about the work of Unlock in supporting people with convictions and will discuss the Ban the Box campaign for employment and consider whether such a campaign would be relevant in higher education. So, I invite you, sir. Thank you.
Thanks, Gail. So to start off the panel today, I'm going to give a little bit of background on the issue of criminal conviction screening in higher education, and particularly at Birkbeck, and then I'm going to set out five reasons why I think this practice is harmful, unethical, and ineffective as a safety strategy. I will argue that universities and colleges should categorically refuse to engage in blanket criminal conviction screening and should be raising critical questions about the increasing escalation of risk management and securitization policies on campuses across the country. So just to give a bit of background, for about 10 years now, all prospective undergraduate students who apply for full-time study in Britain are required by UCAS to disclose any unspent criminal convictions. So the application forms that they fill out has a little tick box that they have to say yes or no, and then those forms are passed on to individual universities and colleges who can then choose to either completely disregard that information or they can use it for screening purposes. So historically, Birkbeck has not used this information for screening student applications, at least not in a consistent or regular way. And this is in part because until 2008 and 9, Birkbeck only had part-time students, so our student applications didn't go through UCAS. So we had our own part-time application form, which didn't have any question about criminal convictions. And then once we started accepting full-time students, then some of our student applications would go through UCAS and had to answer that question, but Birkbeck didn't really do anything with that information. All of that changed this year. So this past summer, Birkbeck decided, without consulting staff or going through relevant committees, to start screening student applications on the basis of criminal conviction. This meant that students who ticked yes to the criminal conviction question would be asked to provide further details about those convictions before their applications could be processed. A similar question was added to Birkbeck's part-time application form, which is new, and also added to the annual re-enrollment process. So students, every year when they re-enroll, they now have to answer this question on a yearly basis. Now, before I set out the reasons why I think this change is problematic, not only for Birkbeck, but for universities more broadly, I want to pause for a moment, and I want to invite you to close your eyes, if you will, or not, and imagine that you are applying for university for the first time. Now, some of you may be current or prospective students, some of you may be graduates or staff or interested members of the public, but I want you to think back or just imagine that you are applying to university for the first time. Perhaps you feel excited about the prospect of studying and hopeful about the possibilities and potentiality that lays ahead. And perhaps you're a little bit nervous. You know that university degrees are increasingly important, and so the social and economic stakes are high of being able to pursue education. You've worked hard on your application, you've submitted your statement of interest, and now are waiting to hear back. Now imagine that someone stops your application and says, wait, we cannot admit you to this university until you disclose to us the worst thing you have ever done in your life. If you don't tell us, we won't accept you here. Or if you tell us you've never done anything and we subsequently find out that you have, it will be grounds for expulsion. We're going to use that information to undertake a risk assessment to determine whether you are too risky to study here. If we allow you to study with us, we may still subject you to increased surveillance and monitoring, but don't worry, this additional scrutiny is meant as a form of support to help you during your studies. Now imagine that someone else comes along and says, no, wait, you may be eligible to be exempt from these questions. If you come from a more privileged background, if you're white and middle class, say, if you had access to quality primary and secondary education, you had family and emotional support, you had decent housing, mental health care, and social activities, you're exempt from answering the question. But if you, on the other hand, come from a background of poverty, from an over-policed community, if you have mental health issues or disabilities, if you were kicked out of your home because you are queer or transgender, if you struggle with addiction issues, you will be subject to additional scrutiny. Now, I imagine that many of you in this room will find the scenario I just described as disturbing. But this is essentially what is happening when we require prospective students to disclose criminal convictions, which leads me to my first objection to this practice. So criminal conviction screenings are discriminatory. So we know that the criminal justice system disproportionately targets the most marginalized and disadvantaged people in society. Your chances of having a criminal conviction are much higher if you're poor or working class, if you're black, if you're a migrant, if you have mental health issues or addictions, if you're gender nonconforming. So while it might seem like asking prospective students to disclose a criminal conviction, it might seem like that applies to everyone, in reality, posing those questions constitutes a form of indirect discrimination because it replicates and amplifies discrimination in the criminal justice system. Now, I'm not going to say too much more about that because my colleague Patrick is going to speak to that, but I will note that this is particularly relevant at Birkbeck, where 47% of our entire undergraduate student body identifies as black or minority ethnic, and 15% has a declared disability. So objection two, these policies will not make our campuses safer. Most of these policies are based on the incorrect assumption that if we screen out or monitor students with convictions, our campuses will be safer. But this is a myth. Criminal records are not necessarily good indicators or predictors of risk or dangerousness. As any criminologist will tell you, most people break the law in some shape or form, but only a select segment of the population tends to get caught and criminalized. As I'm sure everyone knows, for example, the vast majority of sexual assaults go unreported, so most people who commit sexual assault will never have any contact with the criminal justice system and therefore won't be flagged by a screening process. Now, I'm not aware of any research in the UK context that looks specifically at the relationship between criminal convictions and campus safety, but in the US context, a 2010 study, which I've put up here, found, quote, there is no evidence that screening for criminal histories increases campus safety, nor is there any evidence suggesting that students with criminal records commit crimes on campus in any way or rate that differs from students without criminal convictions. So the danger with screening policies is that they provide a false sense of security, giving the impression that we have gotten rid of the danger rather than addressing harm reduction at a broad-based level. The focus on screening means there is less impetus to develop more effective harm reduction and violence prevention strategies on campus. So objection three, criminal conviction screening will have a chilling effect on applications and undermine Birkbeck's widening participation mission. So when I have challenged the new criminal conviction screening policy at Birkbeck, I've been routinely told that Birkbeck is still committed to its mission of widening participation, and as such, rejections on the basis of criminal conviction will be rare. But even if this is the case, the problem is not simply about who is formally allowed in and then subsequently monitored, but also about who might be deterred in the process of the screening process itself. So again, a recent study of the State University System of New York examined what they call felony application attrition rates and found, quote, that almost 2 out of every 3 applicants were denied access to higher education, not because of the purposeful denial of their application, but because they were driven out of the application process. So they either self-selected out, or they, you know, were asked to provide information that they couldn't provide, or the information was insufficient, or they gave up, or didn't want to disclose that information. The study also found that attrition rates disproportionately affected African American applicants. Now, I probably don't have time to go through this today, and it's probably going to be hard to see this from the back of the room, but this is a copy of a sample screening form, a version which Birkbeck has been using, which was provided as an example of good practice by the group Supporting Professionalism in Admissions, which is a steering group body that is funded by HEFCE, UCAS, and Universities UK. And you'll see it's asking people to disclose very detailed information about previous convictions, the nature of the conviction, the court date, the sentence. People are asked about pending cases, so where you haven't even got a conviction. And there's a section which invites you to, you know, contact your probation officer or social worker and get them to provide information to the university as well. So you can see how this kind of form, filling out this form, might put people off. Now, my fourth objection is that criminal conviction screening we can read as a form of double punishment. So once someone has served their sentence and is released into the community, the state has deemed that that person is safe enough to return to society. So the question is why we continue to subject people to other forms of indirect punishment, such as the denial of higher education, housing, or employment. And I'm reminded here of a passage from Discipline and Punish by Michel Foucault, where he describes the situation of ex-prisoners in France in the 1830s. And I'll read the passage. He says, "The condition to which free inmates are subjected necessarily condemn them to recidivism. They are under the surveillance of the police. They are assigned to a particular residence or forbidden others. They leave prison with a passport that they must show everywhere they go and which mentions the sentence they have served." Now, I wonder how much has changed since the 1830s. It seems that we are still trapped in this mentality where people with convictions are never allowed to have simply served their time, but are subject to all sorts of secondary punishments and scrutiny. My final objection is that criminal conviction screening enlists universities in the work of the carceral state, which compromises institutional autonomy, endangers academic freedom, and undermines the very purpose and aims of the university. So on this screen, again, apologies, it's probably hard to see, but you can access it later. It's a sample risk assessment form. Again, this is from Supporting Professionalism in Admissions as an example of good practice. And you'll see there's all these categories and questions where a registrar or a college official is invited to do a risk assessment on a student. So you answer yes and no and write details, and then you rank whether it's medium, low, or high risk. Now, I have serious questions about what qualifies a registrar or other college official who are unlikely to have a background in criminology or criminal justice to undertake this kind of risk assessment, and whether such measurements will accurately capture the riskiness of potential applicants. More importantly, I would question why universities are voluntarily taking on functions that normally fall in the remit of the criminal justice system, and what are the broader implications of this. So I have sat in meetings at Birkbeck where it has been proposed that students with conviction should be monitored throughout their studies by a designated safeguarding officer, that we should be in regular contact with probation officers if students have them, and that we should consider handing over things to probation like attendance records or assessment results. It has even been suggested by some that universities enter into MAPAs, multi-agency public protection arrangements, which would involve universities formally in sentence compliance. Now, this information is partly possible because in many students, in order for them to enter into the system or to get a letter from their probation officer if this is required, they have to sign a disclosure agreement, which basically means that information can pass freely between the two bodies. And that should be cause for concern for many of us. So in my view, all of these practices are dangerous because I think they compromise and transform the role and function of the university from a place of higher learning to one that is complicit with the carceral state. So to conclude, I would argue that the move to criminal conviction screening is part of a broader trend in higher education of escalating risk management protocols and increasing securitization of campus. A 2013 report by colleagues at the University of Glasgow, for example, found that there's a real problem, not just in universities, but more broadly, of what they call disclosure creep. And I'm sure that Chris will have more to say about this. So just to read from a quote, there appears to be a growing presumption of inquiring about an applicant's history rather than a presumption against it. The widening spread or creep of non-compulsory disclosure and legally allowed disclosure of a wide range of information beyond unspent criminal convictions can have a chilling effect on the career and educational progression of significant numbers of people. And one of the other things they point out is that a lot more people than we often estimate have criminal convictions. So this affects increasingly numbers of people, particularly as criminalization trends continue to become enhanced. More broadly, I would argue that this escalating risk management culture is one that perpetuates a kind of climate of fear and mistrust, which then opens the door for increasing control and surveillance. So this is a kind of ethos that I would describe as cynical and paranoid risk management that comes from a fear that anything could happen at any time and the expectation that that anything is dangerous. Left unchecked, this cynical risk management ethos is one that says we should have security checks at the door. We should have metal detectors at the entrances of our buildings. We should install surveillance cameras in all of our classrooms. And then we should never allow our students to take any risks because life is endlessly dangerous. But risk is not always a bad thing. I encourage my students to take risks all the time. I encourage them to take intellectual risks in daring to grapple with new ideas. I encourage students to take educational risks in daring to try something new or experiment with a different kind of learning. And I encourage them to take personal risks in challenging themselves and opening themselves to others. I would describe this as a transformative side of risk. Rather than anything might happen, it's anything is possible. This positive side of risk and possibility, an ethos of giving people a chance, is an ethos that I think has characterized Birkbeck over its 190-odd-year-old history. It's a tradition that makes me proud to work here. But in the wake of the increasing move to criminal conviction screening and securitization, the tradition of opening space for transformative potentialities is one that we're going to have to fight for.
Good evening. My name is Patrick Williams and I work as a senior lecturer at Manchester Metropolitan University. Firstly, I'd like to thank Sarah for the invitation. Can everyone hear me at the back? No. That's a Barry White. No? First, I'd like to thank Sarah for the invitation to come and speak around an area that I didn't really know much about. Okay? So it's quite fascinating and quite valuable for me to be here. However, I'm also going to talk from a position of a previous world that I worked in. My colleague and I worked as research and evaluation officers for the probation service. So in essence, I'm going to focus on those ideas around risk, the construction of risk, and how I will argue that may disproportionately impact on particular groups within society. And from the outset, what I want to do is couch this in two pieces of information that many of you should be aware of. The first one is that in 2003, we had more receptions into prisons of young black, Asian minority ethnic men and into universities. The second fact is that increasingly, the argument goes that we have more levels of disproportionality and prison disproportionality for black, Asian, and minority ethnic men within the UK than the United States of America. So that's my starting point. And essentially, I want to take us back to a point where we recognize that intrinsic to the criminal justice system in England and Wales is disproportionality and differential treatment. And I also want to argue that increasingly we're seeing an increased racialization and criminalization of young black men. And I will argue that this is set against a backdrop of emerging discourses which problematise young black men in particular. So let's look at those individuals who pose a risk in terms of the violent gang. So recently in Greater Manchester, we identified that when we look at particular police databases, we found that 87% of young black men are flagged as being gang involved, although we know that 20% have never been convicted of an offence. Let's look at those individuals who pose a risk of radicalisation and extremism, increasingly black and brown men within the criminal justice system, and those individuals who pose a risk to children and young people around the grooming discourse and child sexual exploitation. For me, it's important that we identify that these are constructs which point towards the dangerous other. Yeah? The construct of the dangerous other. Okay, the enemy within. And I'm drawing on the work of Anderson there in 2014. But equally, we have to recognise as well that these discourses therefore signal a risk that these individuals pose to members of society. And as such, the risk becomes something that the criminal justice system has to manage and contain. What that points towards, therefore, are invisible walls, drawing on the work of Ahmed. Invisible walls which become erected, through which we can protect those individuals within society. Okay? And begin to bar access to those individuals. So that becomes my central point. And I said earlier, I wasn't familiar with the idea of barring access. But in 2008, I joined the university in 2007. 2008, one of my students came up to me and said, "Patrick, can I talk to you after the lecture?" I said, "Yeah, we'll talk." He was a first year student, performing well, getting the grades. At Christmas time, and some lads went out. Yeah, went out for a drink, celebrating Christmas. First year student, no previous convictions. They go to a pub, they get into a barney. That's Mancunian for a bit of a rumble. Yeah, they get into a bit of a barney. It turns out, and I see the video footage as well, he throws a kick. He catches a lad in the head. He goes to court. He is sentenced to 4 years and 6 months. Okay? He got a Section 18 wounding offence. No previous convictions. He serves his time, 2 years. On release, he makes contact. "Patrick, can I come back and pick up my second year?" "Yeah, of course you can." "I go and speak to the head of department." "Yes, of course you can." We go through the admissions process. And it becomes evident very quickly that the institution will not allow the student back into the university because he has a violent offence. We're making reference to the criminal justice system, but his probation officer writes a letter, and this is going back to the probation context, that to give access to university reduces the risk of future offending behaviour. University, education, employment become protective factors around the individual, which reduces the likelihood of future conviction. So the probation officer writes this letter. The institution still refuses access. So that student doesn't come back to our institution. He goes back to another institution and completes his degree eventually. And my argument becomes, and what I'm interested in is that there are a number of key values that should inform criminal justice practice, but also inform how we should respond to those individuals within society who have a history or have criminal convictions. And the first one is that we need to resist the construction of them and us. This spurious delineation between the offender and the non-offender. I also have a conviction. I was a little bambino, but I also have a conviction. We need to resist those temptations to engage in those discourses. Secondly, we need to begin to recognise that, and what probation practitioners used to do, was believe intrinsically in the value and the belief that individuals can change. It's how I embrace my students. It's how we should embrace members of society. And that was always the ethos behind traditional probation practice, that belief in the individual to change. And thirdly, in relation to that, it was applying the appropriate resources to facilitate change in the individual. That means granting access to universities as and when relevant and necessary. Okay, and we need to have an eye on those traditional discourses around risk, because the key assumption, as you made reference to, is that the best predictor of future risk is previous behaviour. Increasingly, that's being disregarded even within the criminal justice context. Okay, So for me, and I guess because I'm here learning from some of these issues, is a key question. For my student, John, I'm interested in what the floor may think and other colleagues. What is the risk posed by my student? And secondly, who is at risk from my student? I guess they're the key questions that I want to present. But in terms of wrapping up, have I done?
You're good.
Fantastic. In terms of wrapping up, I want to point to the ideas that it's my contention that the emergence of regulatory and exclusionary strategies within higher education precipitated on the construct of risk may inadvertently exclude those who hitherto have been excluded and marginalised through the debilitating effects, the asset stripping effects of the criminal justice system. And it's on that basis which I would resist and support the notion of banning the box. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
So now, why don't we come and talk? Have you got a PowerPoint?
No. Okay. Hello.
Let me just put something off in the background.
Hi, I'm Welf. I'm with the Fan Right Protest, as was said. Whilst I just get my notes up, I'd just like to point out the weird orb in the middle of the ceiling, which looks like a security camera to me. So there you go.
Don't worry, you're at university.
Okay. Well, most accounts of student protest over the last 5 years return to 2010, and of course that's important to do. I'll do that myself in a moment. It was undoubtedly the greatest attack on students in the 5 year period of protest that we've seen since the Tory government came in. But I would like to begin briefly with another set of protests that I think reveal the antagonism between students on one side and universities, state, and the law on the other side. The Cops Off Campus protests of 2013 and 14 marked a point where students said no to policing at their university. It came after police repeatedly arrested both students and workers campaigning in the university and engaging in protests in campuses across the UK. The flashpoint in London was nominally the arrest of the president of the University of London Union. This was the elected official who, elected by the student body to represent them, was arrested after a meeting with University of London senior management. I mean, was arrested directly after a meeting with University of London student senior management. So the collusion between police and university was eminently clear. When a protest to bar police access to the university was called, it was done so with the role of with the policing role of the university itself fully being recognised. In fact, the day before the planned protest, an occupation of the university management corridor took place at Senate House, which is that big Orwellian building just outside. Nice Art Deco kind of architecture inside. Police were called in to help clear the protest that evening. Students were forced to flee the building and the occupation via the only route that was not blocked by a mixture of security and police: a ladder propped up against one of the windows. I think the mixed eviction through both police and security is a clear, unreified presentation of how university and police, the state, collude with one another. That after people fleed through this ladder propped up outside one of the windows, the university then allowed the arrest of several students who would later go uncharged. Of course, the next day, which was the first of these Cops Off Campus protests, the tensions were high, to say the least, given that several students had been arrested the night before and the violent nature of the eviction. police and security once again colluded, shutting down all access to Senate House that day. And the TSG, that's the riot police, was sent in. The now standard tactic of kettling and indiscriminate mass arrest took place. Thankfully, though some were charged out of this indiscriminate mass arrest from a kettle, nothing led to convictions and therefore criminal records. The same cannot unfortunately be said of what happened in 2010. Over 100 students were arrested out of the demonstrations that took place in opposition to the rise in tuition fees and the scrapping of the educational maintenance allowance for FE students. The tactic of mass arrest that I talked about earlier, the extended police bail and with no charge, and the eventual no further action and dropping that's become standard practice nowadays on many protests, had not been yet fully developed when these protests happened. Instead, police kettled people for hours, would generally disperse them using police evidence gatherer teams to take pictures as people were dispersed and then chase them up later. But police were certainly out to get people, and this can be seen from the charges that they did bring against students and other protesters afterwards. Though various public order offences were utilised, the most prevalent and most intimidating perhaps was that of violent disorder. The offence is Section 2 of the Public Order Act 1986. I think it's important to listen to the description of this offence in context, I mean in the context of the Act. So I'll read the first three sections of the Act. Give me a sec. Okay, so Section 1 of the Public Order Act 1986 is riot. A riot is where 12 or more persons who are present together use or threaten unlawful violence for a common purpose, and the conduct of them taken together is such as would cause a person of reasonable firmness present at the scene to fear for his personal safety. Each of the persons using unlawful violence for the common purpose is guilty of riot. That's the general description of what a riot is if the state wants to convict you. Violent disorder is one step down from that. Spot the difference. Where three or more persons who are present together use or threaten unlawful violence and the conduct of them taken together is such as would cause a person of reasonable firmness present at the scene to fear for his personal safety, each of the persons using or threatening unlawful violence is guilty of violent disorder. And the third section of the Act is a fray. A person is guilty of a fray if he uses or threatens unlawful violence towards another and his conduct is such as would cause a person of reasonable firmness present at the scene to fear for his personal safety. What we hear is here in the first three sections of this Act is extreme similarities, ambiguities, and a sort of numbers game. You're guilty of riot if there's 12 of you. You're guilty of violent disorder if there's three of you. You're guilty of a fray if it was just you on your own. If we think back to those protests in 2010, there were hundreds of people. They could have quite easily used the offence of riot to prosecute people. There's kind of technical reasons why the CPS don't like to charge people with riots. It kind of gives an impression that the police and the state allowed a riot to take place. But the second offence in the Act was utilised against a lot of students. There's little material difference amongst these offences. The real difference is in the severity perhaps seen in the potential sentences and their varying lengths, as well as, I think, the semantics and the stigmatising consequences of the titles that are given. Violent disorder, when seen on someone's criminal record, evokes something much grander than the acts committed itself. People are convicted of this offence for things such as at the student demos were literally convicted of this offence for things like throwing a placard stick or grabbing a police officer's hat. Why would a conviction for this kind of act bar you from the university? What risk do you pose? As part of the defence campaigns and support that we worked on in Defend the Right to Protest, we found you not only have to battle against the state repression in these long, drawn-out trials for serious offences, but the universities also put up opposition with regards to taking students back after convictions, as Patrick pointed out. This also happened where the state failed to convict, but universities took it upon themselves and made the decision to undertake their own disciplinary action, forcing people through a criminal justice process once again. At times, quite literally, as a friend told me, Cambridge University has its own court, constables, and even cells, apparently. And these aren't just relics. The university court at Cambridge was used to punish a protester through exclusion from the university for 7 terms. If I remember correctly, I think his protest was reading a poem out during a lecture, a public lecture. David Willetts's visit, of course, yeah. Students who occupy their universities also face the dual threat of civil action to get them kicked out, which could then lead to criminal consequences because they're given a high court judgment. Breach of a high court judgment is a contempt of court. But then there's also, again, the university disciplinary. I think, to name names, Sussex, Birmingham and Warwick are examples of where universities have been vicious with regards to post-occupation disciplinaries and exclusions of students, but they're certainly not alone. I just want to finish with by talking about, I'll just read it. Historically, the two notions of education and delinquency have gone together, perhaps since the beginning of the modern educational institution. Education being seen as the antidote to delinquency. But the neoliberal university, as it has been remodeled around the market, has seen delinquency in the form of protest as a threat to education, but a particular form of education seen as a commodity to be sold. Activists in opposition to this model of the university see their institutions as a community to be fostered. Universities screening for criminal records see their institutions as the kind of community that has to be sterilized of all dissent. The kind of demonization is often quite effectively fought against by many activists in the cops off campus and general resistance when universities try to single out people for disciplinary. The question, however, is who becomes quietly excluded? How many of those FE students in 2010 never made it to university? Or if they did, were already too brutalized and had that memory of potential charge, conviction, and just plain old police brutality meant that once they joined the university, they didn't take part in any resistance against and within it. Student protests will continue, but if we don't want it to be solely and perpetually middle class and white, we have to resist barring possible dissenters before they even get to higher education institutions, where they can resist from within and against.
So we carry straight on with Sasha Dark.
Okay, I'm talking today on behalf of British Convict Criminology, a research activist group that's concerned with developing insider perspectives in criminology. And we start from the position that the voices of prisoners and former prisoners are largely absent in prisons research. And we aim to bridge the gap between the so-called expert knower and the lived experience through the prisoner becoming researcher, either working in collaboration with university academics or training to become academics themselves. So today I'll be focusing on this latter issue, on the difficulties our convict members have encountered studying in higher education and more particularly still the relations they have with their universities. We haven't yet researched these experiences in any depth, so the examples I'll give remain anecdotal. So I will not be covering the problems faced by established convict criminologists, you know, who have reached academic positions. We have one member who lost his job as a result of going to prison, so a former academic. But otherwise, so far at least, the few former prisoners we know in the United Kingdom that have gained academic positions have not yet faced problems from their universities. I expect this will change with time. Andy Aresti, for example, a former prisoner who works with me at the University of Westminster, has been refused permission to research in prisons, but as yet there's no indication what view the University Ethics Committee, for example, will take when he does approach them for permission to do research. Okay, so I'm going to briefly give five examples of the discriminatory attitudes that prisoners and former prisoners have faced from their universities, and conclude with some comments on the barriers to prisoners and former prisoners studying higher education that's likely to increase as universities become more and more preoccupied with risk. Okay, so my first three examples concern roles played by universities in policing their own research. So I've not yet come across any examples of undergraduate students being asked whether they have a criminal record when conducting fieldwork as part of their dissertation. I expect this will happen in future, but certainly it appears to be increasingly the case for those doing PhDs and postdocs. So two of the students I have in mind were required to gain ethical clearance prior to accepting their PhDs, to starting their PhDs, for example. One of them, fortunately, was successful just recently, though one member of the committee he had to face dissented, referring to the safety of 20,000 students on campus. The other withdrew his application when he was also told that it was university policy that he could not start until at least a year after his release. My third example is of a student coming close to the end of their PhD, who I spoke to just earlier. He's now looking for a postdoc. He's already approached one university where he was informally told not to bother applying because they would be doing prisons research while he was applying for the postdoc, and there was no way they would be able to get clearance for him to do the research. So here we have a university policing itself, rather than challenging the rules that NOMS and Ministry of Justice have set. Okay, so my second two examples are of undergraduates who went to prison during their degrees. So I'm thinking of two students here who went to prison in the third year of their degrees, who we are currently mentoring. So both were immediately excluded upon conviction. One of them, a criminology student, was informally told not to bother reapplying. And when he finished his sentence, he's now gone on to study with the Open University while still in prison. The other, a law student, sought and failed to get permission from the High Court and the Court of Appeal for judicial review to review his university's decision to exclude him. He then threatened civil action against the university. The university agreed to mediate and at first offered him the choice to do alternative assessments in place of exams or to redo the year with assistance such as recorded lectures, but just the other week formally withdrew their offer on the basis that 5 years had passed since he had finished it, and it's a law degree. They said, you would not be able to complete this degree. I mean, this person here is quite a fascinating case. He's from a very well-off background. He has Terry Waite, a former prisoner himself, who is dealing with the university and on his behalf. But even from that privileged background, he hasn't managed to continue his degree. Okay, so whatever the merits of these cases, what they point to, in my view, though in the case of the law student less expressed than implied, is an increasing concern among universities with the risk of litigation, and I think even more important still, negative media attention. Thinking now of the student failing to get a postdoc, acceptance that certain students will not get access to do prisons research nonetheless. For a while now, critical criminologists have been pointing towards a growing research prevention culture in British universities that privilege policy-focused evaluative research, and with it quantitative over qualitative methods and practitioner over offender participants. Now, I'm not sure how much this agenda is affecting universities' choice of researchers as well as participants, but I am certainly concerned about the risk agenda and how, where that is going to go in serving to exclude prisoners and former prisoners from universities. I'm on the Research Ethics Committee in my faculty. I won't be able to say too much about them, but I can talk about the certain things which are quite open. Now, from my own experience on the Research Ethics Committee, I see this as an organic process of self-imposed censorship among universities, adopting, as I've said, the fear of negative media attention and litigation. And recently we were reminded that individual members of Research Ethics Committee could face litigation. It's not just a university, we were reminded also us individually have to be concerned about the decisions that we make. I'm not a former prisoner, okay, but so another area of risk. I have, for example, myself been refused permission to research in Brazilian prisons, which is my area of research, due to the cost of insurance. And I certainly fear that as universities go down this road towards requiring all research to be insured, I can imagine what it's going to be like when insurance companies start to be asked, are you prepared to insure, or how much would it cost to insure a former prisoner to go back to prison to conduct research? Okay, so besides requiring all research to be insured, my university has also recently introduced the concept of institutional risk. And the most important part of that is the risk to the reputation of the university. And this is now something that we are required on the committee to consider. So again, you can think these are things I suspect they're happening in other universities too. We can imagine where this agenda can take us. Okay, so just a conclusion now. So again, then the potential implications, for critical research more generally, and for us convict research more particular, are clearly enormous. The mentor of the student who was told not to bother reapplying to his university was taken to see the dean of the faculty, who told them not to have any contact with this student due to the risk of media exposure. And this afternoon I had coffee with the person I mentioned earlier, the former academic who then became prisoner. While he was an academic, so we're going back 7 years now, he was selecting students to go to the university. I won't say which university, it's an established university, and they had an informal blanket policy not to accept any students at all who had served prison time. Okay, so I guess I can conclude with the more business-like universities become, the more dependent they become on external resources. This is an agenda which I can only see is getting worse rather than better. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Firstly, just to say thank you to Sarah for inviting me and for being quite open and vocal about Birkbeck. I hope you still have a hope your job's safe. thankfully, I don't have that concern. Slight confessional, I guess, like others here. I've got a criminal record, quite open about that. Just to share, a positive anecdote, because we have been quite negative to universities. I was convicted while studying. And yes, I had to go through what was a very uncomfortable process with my university. Fortunately, I managed to avoid prison. And I was able to study from home for a few months, because that's what I wanted to do. And I was able to complete my law degree. I didn't have a chance necessarily of studying law, of practicing law, but they allowed me to continue. I then went on to study a master's. I completed the master's, but just thinking just now about what I had to do there, I did have to go through a disclosure process, of which they eventually turned around and said, that doesn't matter. But as I'll talk a little bit about later on, I think one of the biggest issues with all of this is that we see the people like me and others that have achieved. What we don't see is all those people that chose not to, and we've heard a few anecdotes already of those that self-select themselves out of going to university simply because of a tick box on a UCAS application. So a little bit about Unlock, a very small charity. We represent the issues, if you like, of what people with convictions face. And when you begin to consider that there's over 10 million people in England and Wales that have a criminal record, we are talking quite considerable numbers. About a quarter of people that are out of work have had a conviction or a caution in the last 10 years. So if we are barring access, as we're discussing, we're barring quite a large number of people, potentially. Sarah asked me to mention a little bit about a campaign called Ban the Box, and I'll say a little bit about what that is, and I'll come back to that at the end, because I think there's some potential for universities to learn from this. Ban the Box is a campaign that's led by a charity called Business in the Community, and that we support, and it's essentially in response to a very similar problem amongst employers. It still exists today, the fact that you can go and apply for a job online, that has an online application process, and when you get to the question about criminal convictions, if you tick yes, you can go no further in that process. You have no opportunity to explain what happened. You are simply forced to either lie or not apply for the job. And statistics vary on this, but about 3/4 of employers accept and recognise the fact that they do discriminate against people with convictions. So what Ban the Box is all about is trying to say to employers, look, asking on an application form is not the right way of dealing with people who have convictions. We go a little bit further as a charity and think, actually, why are you asking in the first place? Let's answer that question first. But for those that do have to ask something, then later on in the recruitment process, once you've decided that somebody is the best person for the job. And one of the things that strikes me a lot at Unlock is that we run a helpline that gives advice to people with convictions. And one of the most striking things I come across is people who have applied for 10, 20, 30, 50 jobs. And every single job that they've applied for, they might have been qualified for. They might not have been the best candidate, but they filled out an application form where they shared the worst moment in their life. Or they've been in an interview where they've discussed for half an hour the worst period of their life, which may have been 10 years ago, 20 years ago. They still never had any hope of getting the job because they weren't good enough for the job, full stop. But yet they've had to share that with lots of people. And I personally know, and I know from people I work with, that's a very difficult process to go through. So Ban the Box is about a more inclusive way of dealing with people with convictions. If you Google it, you'll find lots of employers that have signed up to it, companies like Boots, Freshfields, Interserve, Veolia. These are companies that recognise this has a role to play in their recruitment. Ultimately, to make sure that they don't discourage people with convictions from applying for them, and recognising that what they're trying to do as employers is get the best person for the job, first and foremost. And I think there's some lessons there for universities about how they go about things as well. So just to kind of summarise what I see as being the approach of universities. I'm not an academic, I'm not an expert on the intricacies of universities, but my perception of a lot of people who are looking to go to university is that most apply through UCAS. They see that tick box, they get asked about relevant convictions, and Sarah, you mentioned me as a kind of expert on this, and I feel uncomfortable with that, but when I look at this question, if anyone has a UCAS login after today, please go and have a look at the question and click I, the little information button, and see if you can work out what it actually wants you to disclose. Because I know what I'm talking about here, and I can't figure it out at all. I created a fake login not that long ago to actually see this in practice, and it's terrible. So relevant convictions, they want to know about violence, sexual offences, supply of drugs, firearms, arson, terrorism. But they want to know a lot more than that. These are offences involving. So it's very cumbersome. I've got an apology to make, Sarah. I think you already know this anyway. You referenced the SPA guidance. We are cited in that. It is terrible guidance. We had no control over that whatsoever. It was simply trying to acknowledge a few of the bits that universities get very wrong. But we recognise that that needs to change quite considerably. So don't quote us on that. It's not our fault. One of the things that I've seen a lot with universities, I had a huge battle with a uni that will remain unnamed. Somebody wanting to study a medical course, wanted to become a doctor, they had a caution from over 10 years ago. Not to complicate things, but they don't need to disclose that anymore. It won't come back. The university hadn't explained that. They'd asked, have you ever been cautioned or convicted? And this young lady rang us and said, what do I need to disclose? You don't need to disclose it. She wanted confirmation from the university. So we spoke to the admissions team and said, look, we've got this case, remain anonymous, but will you confirm that? And their advice was, well, she should disclose it because we want to know, but if it doesn't come back, of course it won't be a problem, but we would suggest that she discloses it. So suffice to say, it was me speaking to this person. I said, look, this lady knows she doesn't need to disclose it. Can you get your head of admissions to clarify that fact? Because this was a lady who was really worried. She didn't want to do anything wrong. She didn't want to not disclose something she had to disclose, but she wanted that clarification. So there is this issue of over-disclosure and making people disclose things that cause loads of aggro within unis, creating these admissions teams and committees and what have you. Then they get to it and say, well, you didn't even need to disclose it anyway. Why did you? So there's probably a bit of a cost here to unis in administering all of this. And I guess one other anecdote I want to share is how all of this is pointless. Because universities, apart from in these roles that involve DBS checks, it's all reliant on what you tell them. So unless we're advocating for universities to start doing criminal record checks for every single applicant that goes to them, you are reliant on people self-disclosing. And I know somebody who's done a PhD, looking to apply for post as a lecturer, who is being asked about this question. They've got quite a serious conviction. They're not disclosing it because they know full well that they won't stand a chance. And to them, it's worth the risk because what the risk of a few years worth of a good career. I remember doing that when I was studying and I was looking for part-time work. I was never going to disclose to an employer because I just wanted part-time work for a few months. So when we begin to consider that fact, what value is this actually adding? Because you're only really disadvantaging the people who choose to disclose that. And actually, the ones that are choosing to disclose it are probably the ones that you have the least to worry about. So Sarah outlined some of the good kind of arguments around why universities even bother asking. I guess I just want to kind of summarise a couple of these. You've all walked into here. I don't know who you are. I don't consider you to be a risk to me. I don't consider you to be a risk to one another in this lecture theatre. So why is that any different for people going to university more generally? How is it different to just going to the cinema and watching a film? If we consider that it's to prevent access to vulnerable groups, then we have criminal record checks that exist within certain roles where they're done when somebody is going to be doing that role. So we're not really achieving on that aim either. And we're wasting resources of universities, of people who might not ever actually want to be a lawyer, but might want to study law. And I think some universities justify this on, well, they would never be able to practice. That person might not ever want to practice, they might just want to study law. So I guess just looking at solutions, if you like, I would like to open up this conversation about this Ban the Box campaign and how that may be able to apply to universities. I see no reason in principle why that cannot apply. I think there's a big problem with UCAS driving the agenda on this, and that needs to be challenged. And ultimately, what we want to do is give individuals themselves the autonomy to make decisions for them. So there is some information needed for people before they go on to study about what chances they might have and what might be involved, because what we don't want is people being misled into thinking that if they study a psychology degree, it's going to be plain sailing for them to become a psychologist, because that might not be the case in their situation. But that's for individuals to decide. That isn't for universities or the state or some other greater being. I'll leave it at that.
Thank
you very much.
Well, thank you very, very much for really laying out some of this terrain and both what's at stake, for whom it's at stake, what it doesn't protect us from, and all of those sorts of issues. So as I said at the beginning, I'm going to invite the panel perhaps to begin the kind of conversation by having, maybe there's some questions that you want to pose to each other to begin to start the terrain. And then we'll have that for a little while and then we'll open it more generally, okay?
A question about different universities. I don't know whether there's other universities or people at other universities in the room, but one of the challenges that I see is that each university deals with this on its own. And there's, I don't know how many universities in England and Wales, but how do we raise the profile of any successes that are made in individual universities? How do we raise the profile of that so that other universities can look at that and learn, without this fear of feeling like universities are doing something wrong by not having these kind of processes in place? That's just a general question, really, a thought.
Well, maybe we'll talk about mission creep here. And I think that universities probably going to hear that other universities are going down this path. And as I said, I think it's an organic process. I think people are covering their own backs to some extent. That's the only feeling I have with my colleagues sometimes. People aren't, very few people are prepared to just say, look, I'll take the risk. There isn't a risk, or the risk is minimal. As I emphasise, I think the issue of publicity is a real concern for universities too. I don't know how much this is across some universities, most universities, but I think they're going to learn negatively from each other.
I'd like to ask the panel, because I'm wondering whether I could imagine what might happen at the level of the university admissions. And they might be saying, well, we need to get a certain level of recruitment. We need students to apply and we need to get their parents to say, this is the university we want you to go to. And you can imagine parents looking online and thinking about particular universities and seeing whether this policy is in place, because they're concerned about the safety of Susie and Johnny, you know, or something like that. And that, well, how might we then tackle, it seems to me that what's been put on the table today is that we need to tackle this at so many levels and so many angles of vision, if you like. And that might be another one about what's in the minds of what's in the minds of the university about what they imagine to be in the minds of parents.
Yeah, I was going to say, Stephanie Eaton, who was at Kingston University, her research was, she's been doing research on how many students with convictions are studying at different universities. Mm. And when I spoke to her about it, she said this is the thing that started her on this path was open days, asking parents, how would you feel if there was somebody with a conviction? And she said most parents
said they would be concerned, and that would affect their decision.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is a huge concern. I think one of the points that I was going to make was about how I think this that we need to try and challenge that conversation, because I don't think it is about risk and perceptions of violent people running around universities. It's actually the opposite, which is that the people that we are talking about excluding are normal people that would be good students. And actually the case to universities in a world presumably where they're all fighting for students is to not put people off. So I mean, I think there is that kind of anecdotal evidence, but I wouldn't assume that there is this natural desire amongst parents to think that a criminal record checking process is a good tick against the university. When you actually begin to explain why a university might not, then I think if you've got an argument for that, I think that can be seen as a positive. I wouldn't like to just assume that that's a negative.
No. And I think for my, in my mind, it wasn't so much that it actually is in the minds of parents, but the university might tell us as admissions tutors, well, remember.
I've been doing some work with a particular medical school in a university which has looked at this quite the opposite, which is to ignore everything that happens here around UCAS and what have you, and say, we will only look at people once they're accepted onto the course. We've done a DBS check because it's a medical course, and we bring them in at that point. If something comes up, we'll bring them in and have a conversation. And that was specifically in response to them seeing a huge fall off in people once they sent the disclosure forms to them, and saying, thank you for accepting onto the course, here's the form, and they saw a massive drop off, which I found quite interesting, because that shows that people at that point self-select themselves out.
So two little points that I wanted to make. First is the Glasgow report that I mentioned talked about the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act talks about the balance between the right of privacy of people with convictions and the need for public safety. And that report really challenges that idea that it's a trade-off between one or the other, and emphasizes that actually we need to communicate and get out there that the more that people are in education, the better it is for public safety, because as you know, many people have spoken, education is one of those buffers that protects people against falling into criminalization. So I think trying to change that discourse, because that fear that people may have or colleges may think parents have is, you know, based on false information. I guess the second point that I wanted to make is that one of the reasons I was really excited about running this event here is that I think Birkbeck is actually the perfect place to launch a Ban the Box campaign. We are an institution for adult learners, and so, you know, we don't, historically, we haven't had non-adults coming into the institution, so, you know, we have a widening participation mission that is part of our ethos, and so in some ways, I think Birkbeck is the place that could stand up and say, we do this as a good practice, and I think that might make it much easier for other universities to follow suit, because I do know that there are other universities that don't engage in this practice, but they're, I think people are afraid to make that too public for some of the reasons that are, you know, have been mentioned. So I think embracing that and saying this is something that we will do as part of our mission has a lot of potential.
Okay. So let's open it up. Well, let's take two or three questions or comments at once, yeah? And then people can respond, yeah? Okay.
Do you want me to pick them or do you want to pick them?
Yeah, no, okay, do you want to go? Yeah, I'll see you. And there was somebody over there. Yeah.
Hi, my name's Izzy. I'm doing the master's part-time in cybersafety studies. Thank you for the talk, it's really interesting. Just firstly to say that I'm a strong believer in rehabilitation over retribution. So I'm slightly playing devil's advocate here, but I was just thinking of this question of harm and risk in terms of banning the box entirely. Obviously, one of the things that's come up is talking that there are so many varying levels of crimes, from something incredibly trivial like grabbing a policeman's hat, then more serious crimes such as repeat offences, serious sexual assault. And I'm just thinking from the point of view of a victim of a violent sexual assault, how I would feel if I was at an institution where I was having weekly lectures rather than, I mean, I know you gave going to the cinema as an example of that, but that's a transient experience. And I think we like to think of a university as a community. How I feel as a victim of sexual assault, if I knew that I was having lectures with someone who was perhaps a repeat
Okay, thanks. And could I just make sure that everybody heard? Yeah, we need to do it. So, what she was raising, sorry, what Lizzie, did you say now?
Izzy.
Izzy was raising the point that while she supports rehabilitation, she would be concerned if she knew she was having weekly lectures with somebody else, another member of the class, who was a repeat sexual offender. So that raising that question about harm and risk, putting it back on the table for the panel to think about. Okay, so we'll come to it. You in the blue shirt, yeah? And then you. Okay, and then I'll come to you after the next round, okay? People want to just say their names.
My name is Jose. I guess that this question is mainly for Chris and about his report. So I would like, if you could expand, what is your experience, the countries that you visit, and the approach between the criminal record and universities, if you have any information about it.
Okay. And, yeah, you just... him in that one, yeah. And I'll take you in the next round.
Hi, good evening. My name is Joe Stevens. I'm a senior lecturer over at the London School of Business Management in Law. Two things, really. First of all, I think perhaps some research needs to be done to actually ask all universities what their current policy is. And you might be pleased to know I was halfway through writing a research proposal on that very subject, which is why I came along tonight. So I think we need to know what we're all doing in order to inform best practice. That would be very helpful to start with, because it's very diverse. Secondly, I'm interested in what the panel's view is on not just ban in the box, but what is sort of called the all roads leading to Rome. And an example I have, which is a person who was a PhD student who went to an institution that didn't require them to disclose their criminal conviction, but did require them to disclose their previous employment. During their criminal conviction, they had been sacked, and there was an area where they hadn't worked. So therefore, they were then asked, well, what were you doing then? So it seems there are other ways round. In other words, all roads can lead back to Rome. Were they required to then lie and say, as this person actually did and said they left to study, and then it eventually came out that that wasn't the reason for leaving, and they were disciplined within the student code. So I just wonder how much further you think it should go than just
Okay, I'll get responses to those three questions and then I'll pick up another three. And I see you there. Yeah.
I guess for me, I'm going to respond in particular to the question around harm and risk and how we should respond to those individuals who may have perpetrated serious offences and I know we talk about the victim and the extent to which we should take into consideration the victim's views. I'm glad you did acknowledge that you went to rehabilitation rather than retribution. But I guess it sits at the core of the question you're asking. As I said earlier, I come from a background where this belief in change is possible. It's evident. It's evident in a sense that there are a range of different interventions which we assume are more likely to be effective on particular individuals. Now, don't get me wrong, I don't want to be naive about this, but essentially my argument is if an individual's released from custody or they've served their time on probation in one of those community sentences, then that individual has served the punishment and should be returned back to society as a full citizen. That's the principle. Again, going back to those arguments about the offender and non-offender and the delineation between the two. The question around the victim and the victim's perspective is a strong one, and it's part of me arguing that perhaps we need to have these wider debates and conversations about how we engage in those ideas. But again, it goes back to the point you're making. Who are the individuals within the room? Do we know about these issues? Do we know who the offender and non-offender is? And as such, I would always come from a position that I would support the notion of reducing the levels of risk that individuals pose by engaging them with those activities which are deemed to be effective in reducing that risk.
Anybody else? And the other questions as well.
Yeah, just to pick up on that, following on from that, I think I would say that in those situations, as and when they arise, I think I would hope that universities would be in a position to be encouraging people to come forward if they are concerns, and dealing with them in a way that's responsive to the specific situation, as opposed to trying to take a top-down approach to saying, because that's a problem or a potential that we need to jump all the way up to imposing this really top level process, because there's no guarantees actually that in having these kind of processes that you solve the kind of problem that you've identified, because I'm not so sure that a university would take the details of the victim and cross-reference that with who they have on their student courses and work all of that out. So I would say there's a different solution to that. Jose, thanks for the plug about the work that I did. So it was more about employment and the way that employers deal with things in a couple of other countries. I think a very general point I would make is that other countries tend not to care as much as we do around criminal records. And that's a very simplified way of looking at it, but barring access within European countries particularly isn't something that really exists. Joe, finally, I think ban the box isn't the be-all and end-all. I think what that still forces the point around is that some universities on some courses will still look at criminal records, and you've then got to look at how those institutions make those decisions, because no matter what we achieve here, DBS checks will still exist, and more than what people would imagine, courses involve those kind of checks. So let's not think that they're only the tip of the iceberg. They're actually quite a significant proportion. And Sarah made a very good point about who is it that's making these decisions in universities. And not to try to over-professionalise this, but those people need to know what they're doing, quite honestly. And it's really difficult because I don't think we should be talking about assessing risk at all. That's the wrong language to be using. It's about understanding and then considering what that means in practice, as opposed to trying to turn admissions people into probation officers.
I guess I think I just want to speak briefly to Izzy's question. I mean, I would like call myself a prison abolitionist, but within like the thought around prison abolition, I mean, this question of sexual violence in particular comes up quite a lot, and I think like rightly so. But I think a lot of the thinking and hard work that's been done around that often kind of, well, firstly recognises that accountability doesn't come through, like prisons are kind of singularly bad at like kind of changing people or addressing people's like kind of problems with these kind of things. But I think it's important to point out that our universities are also singularly bad in like addressing these kind of issues. I mean, we have like campus security, but like who trusts campus security most of the time? Where I think the kind of interesting discussions are taking place is perhaps like within certain departments where people are thinking about questions like prison and gendered violence and various forms of interpersonal violence. In a sense, I kind of want to say that it's important that people who have been seen as perpetrators of that are involved in those discussions, so that we can think about it's important for them to think about it, and I think actually they probably have like some kind of important contribution to make. I think that's it.
I'll just say very briefly, but I'm actually coming back to the point that you made, Sarah, is maybe you're going to make it now again. Yeah, about enlisting universities into the carceral state. So I think it's a separate debate. You know, I think if people are dangerous, then we have other institutions to deal with that. And I think as once somebody's been deemed to be safe to be in the community, then I don't think we want to start bringing other institutions into deciding. I mean, for me, that would be the probation service. And if it was a case of somebody wasn't safe to go to university, then I would hope there would be, the probation service that would be doing that rather than universities.
Izzy, that question is one that I am really concerned about, and partly what motivates my interest in the criminal conviction policy. And I think the reality is we already sit in places, in rooms, where there are people who have violated other people's consent. And that's the reality. And so the question is, how are we going to deal with that? And I think, you know, there's been, especially in North America right now, there's a lot of discussion about how to deal with sexual assault on campus. And I think there's a move to more punitive, kick people off campus, create pseudo tribunals, all that kind of stuff. But there's a pocket of other groups that are trying really creative and interesting ways of dealing with sexual assault on campus. So there was a restorative justice project, kind of pilot project at Dalhousie University in Canada. And they were trying to find ways of, when a sexual assault happened on campus, to work with both the survivor and work with the perpetrator and find ways that both could stay on campus, but they could, the survivor could get the support that she needed and the perpetrator could continue their classes but work towards a process of accountability. So it might be an agreement, you can continue your studies, but you're going to have to move to classes that are not, so you're not taking a class with a victim because she's not ready to, you know, be in contact with you for a period. Or, you know, trying to find arrangements on campus so that people could still access their education, but find a way that was meeting people's needs in better ways. And I think there are not a lot of those examples, but I think they offer a lot of promise. And I think we need to be looking into those possibilities more.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to go to the next round now. So I see the man there with the glasses, and you. Okay, so I've got three, and then I'm going to take you to in the third round. Okay, so start here, please.
Yeah. My name's Simon. I work in student services at Birkbeck, and it's likely if we had a policy implemented, student services would be involved in the support side of, supporting people with convictions. From my point of view, I agree with the panel about, you know, if a conviction is spent, if probation service feels that people aren't at risk, we shouldn't be sort of then setting up a second tier around that. So I'd question what use the information would be to the college in the first place, actually. Why they're asking, if they think there are going to be rare circumstances where they would bar people from the college, they need to explain what those circumstances are and why, you know, because at the moment it hasn't really been presented. From my point of view, as someone who is trying to provide support for, people with, there's a higher rate of people with convictions who mental health issues, have financial instability and so on and so forth. And yes, if we want to support people who are having to deal with those sort of problems, knowing about their conviction doesn't help with that. I'd rather encourage people to come forward and talk to us about mental health issues so we could put in place support. And we probably wouldn't be in a position to deal with things like people's, you know, precarious employment and, you know, housing and so on, because they're wider social issues that we can't, as a college, can't deal with. But the knowing about someone's conviction, I'd question how does it help us one iota.
Okay. So the man at the back there, blue shirt,
Thank you very much. My name is Fabian, and I just finished a law program with Birkbeck College in May this year. I listened to the entire speakers address this question of putting people who have convictions through what this gentleman rightly described as a second tier process of scrutiny, in other words, and the traumatizing effects it has on them, the disenabling incidences that follow in the form of exclusion from opportunities like education, employment, and various spheres of life, etc. Now, I want to draw, first of all, I'd like to state here that what these people go through is really traumatizing, and it denies them, as I said, opportunities. I support your view that that universities should not be in this process of putting these people through, putting persons who have undergone convictions through this continuous trauma. Rather, universities are meant to be places of rehabilitation. In other words, they should act as partners in attempts to put these people back on their proper footing. Now, what strikes me most is the rather unforgiving approach of the British society when it comes to people who have spent convictions. By comparison, I and my friends used to discuss of instances where an Englishman in search of, you know, a good job opportunity in Africa thinks he can just put two shirts, two trousers in a bag, bash his way through immigration, become an engineer in Nigeria, get a cook, get a driver, yes, and live a life of luxury in Africa. If we had this unforgiving mentality, you would not have British expatriates milking on a daily basis, trampling on our economy, and getting away with it, getting jobs in Africa that they would not even get in the UK. How many of you have talked about Mark Thatcher, who, if we had an unforgiving spirit like your typical order here in England, how many of you have talked about Mark Thatcher, who did not see the essence of a tiny island like Equatorial Guinea to live in peace and order? Mark Thatcher was a coup plotter caught by Robert Mugabe. Yes, he still has his glory and his face here in the UK. Nobody describes him as a criminal, but technically that is a treasonable offense. So I'm seeking to draw a distinction between the way we reason maturely in Africa. And that's why Margaret Thatcher has Mark Thatcher has his face up here in England. So I would say we've gone very far.
Thank you, Fabian. Thank you for that comment. That's important. The export of the trouble. We know that. The colonial line is long. So thank you.
Hi, good evening. I'm Angela, and I'm the Black Student Officer for Birkbeck Student Union. Mm-hmm. My concern is, like this gentleman, about who are the people that are being targeted for the checks and the concerns over criminal records. Because we know that there are a certain group of people that seem to be disproportionately affected by these checks. They don't seem to be people like Julie Saville or high-profile MPs. It's always either ethnic minorities, people who are disadvantaged living in poor environments. But the thing is, the checks, the concerns concern us all, whether you're black or white or mixed race. Mm. That's not the issue. The issue is the aftermath, the ongoing effects after the fact that you cannot be admitted to university, because we all are subject to these checks. But it's who, in a majority, is disproportionately affected by these checks. Because some of us may not be aware of the ethnic penalty. You're a woman, it's a gender issue. You're black. So all these issues have an adverse effect on the black community. That is my view.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so responses to those comments, really, and queries, elaborations, please?
Yeah, just Simon, your point about how does it help? Mm-hmm. I think to take a slightly less ambitious approach to this work, I think one of the things that I would value most, if the status quo was to remain, if you like, would be for universities to at least be clear to people as to what they want from people, when, and why. Now that's a really unambitious approach, but one of the difficulties that I see a lot is people just not knowing what's going to happen and when, and that can create a lot of fear. I still think there's a big question about the value of the information in the first place, and we get a lot of contact from student services people up and down the country who have people with convictions walking in with all these types of concerns. So I think support services in universities play a key role actually in helping people through these issues. And Angela, I guess the point that I'd make in response to your comment is that's, I think there's a strength in that argument that needs to be taken forward with this kind of work, because I think one of the issues, and the same goes for employers as well, is how this is indirect discrimination. And although we don't have the benefit of using the Equality Act directly because of criminal convictions, because it's not in there directly, as a protected characteristic, there is an argument that hasn't been established legally, but there is a lot of evidence to show indirect discrimination, and that argument has got some traction in the US, and I think that we can learn from that over here as well. Because mm-hmm. I think things like that make universities stand up and listen.
If only. If only.
No, I think, yeah, pick up on the point of indirect discrimination mm-hmm. as well. I just add an extra point to that, which is what I'm involved in convict criminology, because for me, for a selfish reason, what I'm interested in is developing my discipline, and we have a situation in criminology, and no doubt many other subjects as well, where the people who are the expert knowers, the people who are researching, do not have that. They're not on the other side. They're not the people who have convictions. They tend to be white and middle class. And so I think the indirect discrimination is important as a societal issue, but it's also important for academic knowledge and development of our disciplines. Mm. Mm.
And Will? Yeah.
I was reading the... this was quite a while ago, so I might forget pertinent details, but the University of London's disciplinary procedures, and the fact that at the University of London, so if you were to be convicted of a crime, the view of the disciplinary board would be that they would just take that for read, and you wouldn't get any further kind of say if you were convicted of a crime whilst you were on your course. Obviously, the University of London is a weird collegiate institution, and colleges can resist that at various levels, but I think it is quite important for people to look at what their university's disciplinary guidelines are, because often it's quite occult and you don't really realise what they entail until perhaps you fall foul of them. Mm. I'm going to respond to what Angela said agreeing with what you pointed out, and just taking that a little bit further and talking about another category of people. I'm not sure if people have seen, but there's been research into the number of students who undertake sex work whilst they're at university in order to get themselves through university. It turns out, unsurprisingly, perhaps for some of us, but that it's quite a lot of students undertake some form of sex work whilst they're at university. And I think that if we're going to be talking about stopping barring access, this is one of the things that we should be campaigning on in terms of decriminalising sex work. The NUS Women's Campaign have, I think, important motions that they've been bringing in terms of decriminalising sex work. And I think people campaigning around that in order to would be important as well in this regard.
I'd just like to say that was a really interesting round of questions. And I guess there's a number of value bases which kick in at that point. And the point at the back, not to reiterate what you're saying, but I guess colleagues and I in Manchester engage in this idea about who has the power to define what is criminal and non-criminal, who has the power to define crime up, who has the power to define crime away. And it links into a piece of work that a colleague in Manchester has undertaken in relation to drug dealers. Mm. And his cohort of drug dealers were white students who supplied drugs to other white students who went to parties and took those drugs, none of whom have been detected, stopped and searched as drug dealers. And we find it really interesting as a piece of work, and it was an ethnographic study which was undertaken. And then I think back to the release report, the release document which was published a couple of years ago, which points to the high levels of stop and search, but then the discretionary powers of the police on who they charge and who they release. So it's important that we don't take our eye off who has the power to define up and define when it links into Angela's point again in relation to the FCA penalty. It's extremely naive for us to not recognise that such powers and such discriminatory powers will disproportionately impact on particular groups and communities. And increasingly we talk about punishing partnerships. So we see probation, prisons, yachts, social services, Job Centre Plus, coming together as a way of managing and responding those problematic groups within society. It's extremely difficult, therefore, for me to not acknowledge that the university is also becoming a part of that punishing partnership. Right. And it's on that basis that we should challenge that ethnic penalty and begin to ensure that we're vigilant in terms of who will this disproportionately impact. I mean, anecdotally, I spoke to a student who does a lot of, sorry, a young person who does a lot of valuable work in terms of mentoring young women, young black women within the community. And I met with her and we were talking and she's 24 and she, yeah, but was kicked out of school at 15.
Mm-hmm.
But have you thought of going to university? No, can I go to university? I've got a conviction. And we begin to have those conversations with young people within our communities at that point. And I think it's important that we almost begin to put it out there that universities are accessible. And it's relevant to the student support services because you bang on, for me, there's this argument increasing that we need to shift away from the risk discourse. It's not useful. What we need to do is focus on the needs of individuals and respond to those needs. So when we have students who present with mental health problems or financial problems, we respond to those issues. Coincidentally, we often argue that they're the same variables that also contribute to offending behaviour. So it's important that what we begin to do is access and respond to the needs of individuals rather than becoming preoccupied with the risk that these individuals pose. And there's a number of critical theorists who will argue that in effect what we're doing is criminalising poverty.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we're building risk constructs around poverty. And it's important again that we reintroduce that back into this debate and not lose sight of it. Mm-hmm. And I just want to come back quickly to this point, not running the clock down, but we have to also acknowledge that when we begin to have conversations around ban the box, unlock, and almost begin to advocate for individuals who we believe should have an equal access to the provisions and resources of society, we often shift to the outlier as a way of negating the campaign. And the outlier often becomes the sex offender, the paedophile. Well, what do we do with those individuals? And we need to be careful and strategic that we don't allow the outlier, the Bulger case, to legitimise and open the door to the hyper-criminalisation of young people under the new Labour regime, and increasingly, the hyper-criminalisation of increasing the students. So I just want to park that there as well.
Thank you.
Hi there, I'm Mark, a law student. I was going to say, what you should do is just do a campaign of telling everyone not to tip the box and just say no and lie, and then the university do the check, then when they run out of money for doing the checks and they haven't got enough admin staff or time, they get rid of it anyway. Let's be fair, there's cuts going on everywhere. But obviously you can't do that. So, no. I was going to say, one thing that I've noticed, and this is from something I saw in the student room, is that a lot of people don't even know that their spent convictions and the Rehabilitation Act changed. So they still think they've got to wait 10 years or whatever amount of ridiculous time it was before for them just to say, oh, I once upon a time had a drink driving offence or whatever. What I think, and there was a person in the student room and this part was like, I want to go to uni, and funny enough, mentioned UCAS, and someone said, oh, just press the little box that you're on about, and it'll tell you what you've got a thing. And he had no idea what the hell I was actually asking him to actually declare. It doesn't tell him the time scales, how long, when he has to declare a spent conviction or not, and so forth. And I think, wouldn't it be a good idea be to work with UCAS at the moment, because they're not going to change their minds overnight anytime soon, into actually making it clear that actually, on most things now, they're spent quite early. They're spent 6 months after you've finished your punishment and so forth, so you don't actually have to declare it at all. And I think one of the biggest things is people don't know when they do and do not need to declare their convictions, and how you think that you can engage with getting that out to people.
Thank you. And then, so you there? Great. Yeah. And then you.
Thank you. My name is BC. I'm a student of public. I could see the two point of view of somebody who's been affected by a sexual act and the need not to disclose as well of past spent convictions. Now, I believe what could be done under the circumstance is that otherwise there is a perfect reasonable ground for the affected individual to sort of feel like she has a right to know of what has happened and her safety. Then again, we have to think about the opportunity that is going to be denied to quite a lot of people along the line. So my ways of looking at it is a line should be drawn somewhere. Say, you come into this university, what you've done in your past years, you draw a line on that. And then the university then comes with a clear strategy in terms of communicating to all individuals within the unit that if you do X, Y, Z during the course of your being in this unit, then this is what is to follow. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, a lot of people that has got convictions that hasn't got no relevance will eventually be denied by just ticking the box. So I believe moving on from what has happened in the past by the union setting it clear.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, it's up there. It's great, brownish. Yeah, there. Okay. I've got you next.
Hi, Ruth Armstrong. I'm based at the Institute of Chronology at the University of Cambridge. Myself and Amy, who's here, we are absolutely thrilled to be here. What a great event. We've been running a course in HMP Grendon this year with students from the University of Cambridge and students serving time in Grendon presently. One of the things that we've learned through running that course is that learning with people we might not otherwise encounter in life expands our worlds and our minds and our personal growth for ourselves and for all of our students. Within Grendon, one of the things that we found really interesting, and this is a different policy to other university initiatives similar to ours, so because it's a therapeutic community, we have not barred people knowing about the full humanity of everybody present in the room, whether that be negative things in their past or positive things. We are there as all of our fragile and messed up humanness is all welcome and present in the room. And I think in terms of the Ban the Box initiative, we're hugely interested in being part of some network and moving forwards. One of the things that we learned from our students was the importance of being able to access spaces and people that you might not otherwise have accessed through this course. And so we've been working, trying to work out how we make those spaces within university open to people who are currently serving time in prison and after their sentences within prison. Within that, with another hat on, I have been part of an initiative that's working through NOMS called the Welcome Directory, which is working with faith communities to try to equip them to help people leave prison, come into communities well. Part of what it's doing is helping faith communities to understand what that looks like, how you do it, and how you don't just work alongside probation to be more risk averse than probation ever would be, because they know what they're doing largely. So one of the things that I wonder is if maybe actually being able to have your convictions known is important. A point Patrick kind of made, basically why you want to do that is the important thing. And how is it that we could equip universities to welcome people, because it will increase and improve our learning, which is what we're meant to be about.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay. Responses again?
I'll go first, since I'm the one holding the mic. Mark, I completely agree with you. It's one of the biggest frustrations I have working for a small charity that we do so much to raise awareness and we still only scratch the surface. So we campaigned for those changes. We did a huge amount of work. I was sat on BBC Breakfast on the day the changes came in, and still we get calls every day from people saying, I never knew this had changed. It's always going to happen. My plea to everybody here is if you ever see anything referring to the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act that's out of date, please tell them. It has changed. It doesn't take 10 years for a prison sentence to become spent now. It's much less. We have a disclosure calculator that anybody can use free of charge, put in their details, it'll tell them that their convictions are spent or when they will become spent, hopefully. And we've got posters on our website that people can share. I was doing some work yesterday looking at a university I can't remember the name of it, but they still had in their policy section the old Rehabilitation Offenders Act. So every university needs to look at this, and it's clear that that hasn't happened so far. And then just, Ruth, on your point, one of the things that I constantly question is whether we should be pursuing an agenda that seeks to forget criminal convictions and allow people to keep them private, or whether we should recognise that we're effectively moving towards the US model of more stuff being open to everybody, and rather whether we should just forgive instead and that be open. I'm not so sure that we've got such a forgiving society at this point to suggest that that's the way forward, but I think it is really interesting research that you were talking about, because I know that's true, which is that when I speak to somebody about me and my criminal record, they don't judge me because they know me, and they say, oh, well, you're different. Well, I wasn't many years ago, and you might look at me now as seeing a white middle-class person, but I wasn't many years ago. So I think there is some value in that, but I would caution against placing too much trust in the public to make that kind of intricate judgment, especially at a high level, like the way that universities approach this issue.
I would just say briefly that we've mentioned it several times already, but we just can't underestimate how difficult it is for people to, you know, to disclose. And I certainly know from my experience, time and time again, when people get knockbacks, sometimes they don't know whether it's based on their record or not. People really do get knocked back by rejections, and applying for university as well. I just think we really can't underestimate how difficult it is for people. I mean, I agree, Ruth, that I've taken my students to Wormwood Scrubs prison. They change their mind immediately over their image of people who are serving prison sentences. But so I wouldn't want to use that in the classroom, not without somebody's absolute consent.
I mean, just quickly on this kind of the public nature of whether someone has a conviction or not from the perspective of a protest. I mean, most crimes that are committed, you won't end up in the newspaper, but if you committed a crime on a protest, it's the Daily Mail likes to put your picture out there and kind of like make light of the fact that you've firstly been at the protest, because they don't know whether you've done anything or not, and they blindly reproduce police kind of mugshot press releases. So I think that's another kind of issue with regards to the public nature and of disclosure. And how it impacts on student protests.
I wanted to add something about, there's a kind of question about what students could do, should students not disclose or disclose, and I think actually we do, it's a local issue because universities have discretion to decide whether they're going to do the screening, but it's also a national level issue, because as long as that question appears on the UCAS application form, the response, when I've said to, people in Central College that, well, we just don't have to, we could ignore that information. And they say, well, that will be a liability, because if we knew that the information was there because it's on the UCAS form and then we didn't do anything about it and an incident happened on campus, we could get sued and we would be neglecting our kind of duty of care to students. And so I think there needs to be a push from students through the NUS, through other kind of channels and through staff to get that box removed from UCAS, because then I think there will be, it'll be up to universities to have to decide what they're going to do and develop their own protocols, and I think it will be harder for them to do that. So I don't know, I think John is here from the student union at Birkbeck and maybe wants to speak to this, but there was an attempt to get a motion passed at the NUS. It wasn't successful this year, but I think there are attempts to try and push it through in the coming year to get the NUS to come out against the box on the UCAS applications. And I know UCAS might not necessarily just listen to students, but they give a lot of lip service to student, what students want. And so I think if students and staff are pushing very hard to get this box removed, that would be a really important step forward.
Can I just very quickly, Mark made the point about slightly tongue-in-cheek about not ticking the box. let's be honest, that happens a lot. And I have no fear in saying that our helpline speaks to people on a daily basis that are in those kind of positions, whether it be in applying for a house, applying for insurance, applying for a job, applying for university. That happens. And I recognise that, because while we still have the kind of fear attached to disclosure that we do have, and the questions of why that's even needed, people are going to make those kind of decisions. So it is a bit more complex, because clearly many people can be found on Google, and so they can be found out. But I think it is an interesting challenge to put back on universities to really start to ask the question, what value is this actually adding? Because the point I made earlier, the people that are coming up into your notice are only those that are the ones that have actually self-disclosed, and many of the universities don't even collect that kind of data, so they have no idea. But I suspect it will be a massive underrepresentation to what we know exists out there around the number of people who have convictions.
Sorry, I'm not very good at public speaking, but there's a lot of things that's wound me up about this tonight, but I just want to hit on something. Criminal convictions, crime. I think universities need to realise that crime is not a solid thing. In Parliament, new crimes are made all the time. We can laugh and joke, and I go out there, spit on the floor, criminal. Now you're off your course. All of this. There's a hierarchy to crime. It needs to be looked at bigger. There's already now, within a lot of areas, people look at university and students in university as different to them. I know I come from North Stockholm. Where I grew up, I'm the first person in my family to be at university. Only two friends have been at uni but me. Even now, 2 years in, I still get calls from people, you're in uni, and it puts a barrier. But my thing is, that I really want to get onto this thing about risk management. I had this argument with a lecturer once, not an argument, I said, but about risk management. Now, within uni, they're trying to make it, okay, you have a criminal conviction, risk management, we need a team, we need to watch. Who's more dangerous? In that sense of risk management, someone that's stolen something, or a trained soldier that's killed people in combat and come back, who's going to be the most one to be a risk management to? Who, if they had a psycho episode, is the one you've got to watch out for more? Or even the boy soldiers in Africa that were brought over to America and here, they're given free slates and educations, and people are not told who they are and they're put on there. Again, this has to be looked at bigger. If they're going to talk risk management, we need to look at real risk management. People that are applying for university are probably not career criminals. I know career criminals. I've seen the money they make. They have no need for university. They're going to live good lives. They take the risk. I have a friend that has 3 kids. He goes in and out of jail every couple of years. I literally tried to talk to him once. Have you thought? Dude, I've got over 100 grand in cash in my house. I look after my 2 sons. What do I need? And he takes the risk of going to prison for a year here, a year there to do that. Those are career criminals. They're not looking at university. But you have other people that will make mistakes that realize now we're in a neoliberal system where if you don't have a degree, you're going to be held back. And straight away, pick up the application. Do you have that box? You're right, that box. We're putting everything down to a box. We're boxing, we're labeling people. Why don't universities just go Nazi and ask criminals just to wear an armband so we can identify and keep away if so chosen? This is a dangerous, dangerous precedent. Well, I can hear a lot's going on there. So I just needed to vent what was on my mind there.
Thank you.
Thank you for all your talks. I wanted to maybe ask a provocative question, which maybe you won't want to answer, so don't worry if you don't. A few of you have spoken about moving away from the discourse of risk, and I can see very much the argument for this. Of course, we have to ask at the same time who risks what and who these risks are for. Normally, when you look at where universities identify risk, as Wael has said, and this is in this neoliberal system, you'll find it on their financial books. I remember reading the financial accounts of KCL in 2013, and there's a very sort of beautiful risk map that the university might suffer from. And I think also like, we should be clear that there's a difference between the risk to the university and the risk to students. When I think about the risks to society posed by the university, I think about things like, you know, the fact that they teach like business and management or weapons tech, or you know, have masters in resilience and shit like that. That shit really scares me. That is a great risk to all of us in this room. And so I was wondering if you think there's a space of, you know, of using risk here, and like, it seems to me that, you know, the university's become these great whirlwinds of myths in which the future is entirely bound to the present through the concept of risk, or even the past with spent convictions, you know, being the risk that might happen in the future. But is there not a moment of possible breaking out of this, of, you know, using the risk against them? You know, the university says, what's risky for them? We should say, sure, we should make this a bloody risky place. You know, at what point should we be saying, actually, the universities as they stand are themselves a risk to us, and we will use this, their own strategies against them to, you know, put them at financial risk. We have to say, you know, we don't want these places to necessarily be profitable for what you're using them for anymore. Is there an argument of not stepping away from the risk discourse, but of refunctioning it against them as a sort of mode of destroying the university as it currently stands?
Hi, my name's Stuart. I'm a student here at Birkbeck. Going on from a couple of the other things, it's... One is about the risk issue, and once a risk has maybe been highlighted or flagged, how that risk is then qualified, quantified, assessed, and dealt with. Because the looking at the administrative processes going in from the moment, the one that we're looking at for CRBs and for criminal things seems to be incredibly similar to the ones around mental health disclosures, which again have to be put on at the initial application, where basically it's a screening out process. Not with all the universities, but in a lot of circumstances, and certainly going into the work sphere, there is certainly a parallel there. But what it does seem to go to is almost an ideological, a political ideological thing of a moving more into the conditionality of the status of the individual. And it's ways of disenfranchising based on an administratively or bureaucratically valid system, or something that they could at least argue has some kind of validity based in statistics, rather than asking what those statistics actually say.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Is it two more there? You both put signal in. Are you signalling? Okay, I'm going to take these two. Yes, I'm. Hold your
mind. I'm going to do that two. When we get to six, I think it's too
strong. You cut too much? Okay.
No, go on. No,
all right. Now, okay, I'll come back to you, yeah. And then you two will be the final ones. Okay, go.
No,
with
sorry.
The
take the
no,
questions.
Go. Okay. Go. Honestly.
Just in responding to the four, five, I guess the commonality for me is this notion of risk. And again, who's defined in and who's defined out. In preparation for tonight's event, I asked the HR department. What proportion of staff at Manchester Metropolitan University have a criminal conviction? Mm. And he looked at me and I explained where I was going and what I was involved with. And he says, well, I can't give you that information, because if it goes in the public domain, then we may have parents who are reluctant to send their students to university. And I found it a really interesting point. I also found that we do capture the information. So there's a report on a central database which asks, criminal conviction disclosures by students. So we know the data is being captured, and I guess it takes us to the point that you're making. If we capture the data, then people can ask for the data and then begin to infer findings from that data and that information. I guess for me, the tension about whether we can appropriate risk and use it to our own ends becomes problematic, because it almost suggests that we almost begin to ontologize risk, don't we? Mm-hmm. As if it's something there for us to take ownership with. Mm-hmm. And this part of me would accept the basis that the risk discourse is owned by and utilised by those in positions of power, mm-hmm. to exclude, and to push out those with less power. So I guess that would be my starting point, or that's where I would come from. And I guess for now, this sounds like one of those conversations I'm going to have in the pub, so I guess I'm going to park it there, and then we'll sift it, have it later on.
I think I'll try to give some kind of response to Jacob because I don't think anyone else will. I think it's important to... I think I tried to draw out the fact that we're constantly in antagonism with our universities, the fact that we struggle within and against these institutions for various reasons, the fact that sometimes there are important bits of work happening within our universities which couldn't happen anywhere else, but if they could happen elsewhere, academics would have fled long ago. But I don't know, I kind of go back to the image of putting the university on trial. I'm not sure about putting people on trial, but perhaps putting institutions on trial is important. Going back to your kind of like question of going after those moments of risk within the university, I mean that we can kind of be as antagonistic as we like. I mean, we can steal the sword from the hands of the university in its moment of blindness and take it against itself, but that is the moment where they come back with the state, right? That's the moment where we begin this kind of re-begin this process of the criminal and criminalization, and these at the end of the day, these are in their current form, the university is a important financial instrument that needs the protection of the state and constantly relies upon the protection of the state. And it turns out that the protection of the state is even more brutal than the brutality of the university. So.
The only point I wanted to make was Jennifer's point. I've lost you there. Data protection and organisations' duties under data protection law. I think there are certainly arguments here. There is history to that in that that's what has driven UCAS to change the question that they ask. They did historically ask a very generic question and they were challenged by the Information Commissioner about the relevancy of that. And then there was a case back in 2008-09 of a student called Majid Ahmed who looked to study medicine at Imperial College. And he was refused and eventually got into Manchester, University of Manchester, I think. And at that point, UCAS looked again at whether they should have this question under data protection principles, because if they're collecting it, what are they doing with it? Is it proportionate? Is it of use to them? So I do think there's a quite technical argument. It doesn't challenge some of the kind of points that we've made today, but it might lead towards a similar kind of solution.
Thank you very much. This is I'm Ozan Kamdot from School of Law. Actually, you just commented on it. I will kind of repeat you. I think what should go with this whole discussion that we are listening today, which is on the students with conviction, should go parallel with the discussion on the universities. And the big question is what university is. And I think we need to think about this question somehow getting. Not to be squeezed between neoliberal or non-neoliberal question or the university. Yeah, we know neoliberal is going on and we know its effects, but what about what university is in a positive way? I mean, because there were some comments which says like rehabilitation, you know, it's maybe a responsibility of the university or it should be a part of university structure. Some other comments said like university, you know, these students with conviction are really good for learning and teaching, I don't know. So is the learning main objective of the university, or is the rehabilitation, or what university is, is it a community? I mean, I think this discussion and this, as you said, the taking this word in our hand and turning to universities, very healthy and needed, especially when I listen to all these discussions.
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Marlon. Thank everybody who gave their contributions. Interesting
conversation that's been taking place today. I think my interest is in, well, I have one question really, but preface it slightly. I don't personally see the difference between the educational institution, the police institution, the institutions that look after social welfare, housing and such. I don't see any differences in those institutions ethically, historically. So my one question is, who actually has the real leverage? Who has the true leverage to move the position into a position to say, okay, let's get rid of a box or let's accept certain people? Because it seems to myself that anybody who would get to make what Gail, I think, and Sarah spoke of as discretionary decisions, they don't come from my estate. So I'd be interested to know who actually gets to make those decisions and how much leverage, true leverage, do people like myself or who else, whoever else is here from a lower income background gets to have an actual say or who can actually move the institution to a position of saying, okay, yes, I think we'll go with what you're saying. So that would be my question. Who is there any true leverage on the outside? Because it seems there's been like two or three discussions taking place on the outside as to in terms of criminal convictions and how people can be prepared to go into universities who are outside the university situation. And those who are inside the university who get to make the decisions on saying whether they can or whether they can't by whichever mechanisms or means. So that would be my question. Who has the true leverage like outside to actually move these people who have discretionary decision power to actually say, yes, okay, we think you might be right in what you're arguing for?
We do. I think... as I was introduced, I work with this organisation called Defend Right to Protest, and we have this kind of motto that you defend right to protest by protesting. Of course, all of these questions about risk come into question depending on your subject position within society, whether you're at more risk of being criminalised or not. But I think... Getting involved in struggle at the university is important. Get involved in the cleaner struggle. Get involved in struggles against course closures. Get involved in these struggles and fight back against and within the university. I think that's important and brings into question exactly who it is that has the leverage. If we're on a moment of pivot, we should take the opportunity to swing it our way.
Yeah, just to add to that, I think I'm constantly amazed at how, yes, I work for an organisation, but just as a person asking questions of, you know, senior people in universities and asking serious questions, and the more people that ask those kind of questions, you'd be amazed at how, if they get through to the right people, people that may not have even considered them before, are able to consider them. So we have a strategy of using anecdotal cases that we see as the leverage that to take cases to, whether that be employers, insurers, universities, and that does work. And so the more pressure that everybody can put on these things, I think universities on this particular issue, universities are in a position to make some decisions, and they collectively, I think, and this is where discussions across universities need to take place, collectively are able to say to people like UCAS to put the pressure on, because I've been in contact with UCAS for a while. I know this is videoed, so I'll be careful, but you know, they've not responded to the issues that I flagged up to them over a year ago around just the help text that they have on their application process. Now, if a load of universities said, hang on a minute, we're getting loads of people disclosing stuff that they don't need to, they would sit up and listen to that. So universities collectively have a bit of power in this as well.
Just to connect those last two questions, I think it's right to bring into the room the institutional legacy that shapes the room that we're in now, or the institutions that we inhabit in terms of the colonial legacy and the class legacy and the, you know, the ways in which these institutions reproduce structures of power. But I also think it's important to remember that the university still, you know, despite neoliberal forces, despite the move to kind of consumer-based education, is still a place where resistance, critical thinking is possible. I mean, it's less possible than it was before, but it's something that I think, you know, people have fought to be able to get access to university. People have fought to change who gets to sit in the room. And I think we need to kind of to hold on to that in these moments where it feels like, where is the leverage? And so I think we do need to be posing the questions again and again, what is the university for? Who is it for? Who has a stake in that? And not in that kind of neoliberal framework, but in terms of, you know, building communities of critical thinkers and engaged people in the community.
Okay, so thank you really so much. It does seem to me that there is so much being put on the agenda in terms of things that we action needs to continue and be done. So one of the things that we do have the room until 9, so it may be that there are some people who've indicated that they might be wanting to kind of think about linking up, finding ways to think together across institutional sites in order to get some kind of campaign. So this next bit then will kind of break from here. And people who want to do that should stay and talk with Sarah and the others about how you might kind of begin to build up a bigger network on that, yeah? And certainly to take that forward. And in terms of my own teaching, I have to say I didn't know that we had that on the form. I didn't know that until recently. Because we, as an admissions tutor, I don't see that when I look at the applications. It's all hidden from view. So there's a way in which it's all made secret as well. It's an institutional secret from those of us who are doing admissions. So now I need to now do some work in my department about what the hell is going on here. You know, so there's that kind of thing too. So I'm going to close it now. Thank you really, really very much, everybody, for kind of getting us going. And I think it is about trying to generate some leverage across the site. So I invite people to stay if you want to in terms of hooking up. Yeah? Thank you.